welcome to Theater UNO's production of Hedda Gabler. A few things before we get started. Please, no photography during the performance, and make sure to silence all cell phones and noise-making devices. On your way out, we ask you to please recycle your programs. Thank you, and enjoy the show.
Rummaging through archives, marvelous old documents no one knew existed.
You've certainly not wasted any time on your wedding trip, George.
I certainly have not. Oh, but do take off your hat, Aunt Julie. Here, let me help you.
Goodness, it's almost exactly as if you were still back home with us.
My, what elegant hats you go in for.
I bought that for Hedda's sake.
For Hedda's sake?
Yes, yeah, so Hedda wouldn't feel ashamed of me if we walked down the street together.
Oh, Aunt Julie, you think of everything. But let's sit down and have a nice little chat until Hedda comes in.
How wonderful it is to have you right here before my eyes again, dear boy.
And for me to see you, Aunt Julie, you who have been father and mother to me both.
Oh, I'm sure you'll always have a place in your heart for your old aunts.
Yes, but Auntie Rena, is she any better?
Well, we can hardly expect that she'll ever be any better, poor thing. She lies there, she has all these years. But Lord, let me keep her a little while longer, because honestly, George, without her, I don't know what I'll do with my life. The more so now that I don't have you to look after.
There, there, there.
Oh, no, but now to think of it, that you are a married man, and that it was you who carried off Hedda Gabler. Imagine the beautiful Hedda Gabler, she who always had so many admirers.
Yes, I rather suspect I have several friends who would like to trade places with me.
And to have such a wedding trip, 5, almost 6 months.
Yes, but remember, I used part of that time for research, too. All those libraries to check and so many books to read.
Yes, but George, isn't there something special you have to tell me?
From the trip?
Yes.
No, not that I recall, beyond what I wrote you in my letters. Well, they gave me my doctor's degree down there, but I told you that last night.
Yes, of course you did. But I mean whether you have any kind of expectations?
Expectations?
Oh, George, goodness, I am your old aunt.
Oh, yes, quite naturally I have expectations.
Ah.
I have every expectation in the world of being made a professor soon.
That's right, a professor.
Or perhaps I should say I'm certain of it, but Aunt Julie, you know that perfectly well yourself.
Yes, George, we were talking about your trip. It must have cost a terrible amount of money.
Yes, but remember that big fellowship took us a good part of the way.
Yes, but I hardly see how you could stretch it enough for two.
No, that's not so easy to see, is it?
No, and especially traveling with a lady, for I hear tell that is much more expensive.
Yes, well, it is a bit more expensive, but Hedda had to have that trip. She just had to. There was nothing else to be done.
No, of course not. And I do hear that a honeymoon abroad is the thing nowadays. But now, George, tell me, have you had a good look around your house?
Oh, you can bet that I have. I've been up since daybreak.
Yes, and how does it strike you, all in all?
First rate. Absolutely first rate. Only I don't know what we'll do with the two rooms between the back parlor and Hedda's bedroom.
Oh, my goodness, George. I'm sure you can use them as time goes on.
Yes, as time goes on and I build up my library, huh?
It was your library I meant, my dear boy.
Oh, yes, and I'm most happy now for Hedda's sake. Before we were engaged, she used to say so many times there was no place she would rather live than here in Secretary Falk's townhouse.
Oh, to have it come on the market just after you'd sailed.
Oh, yes, we've really had luck, haven't we?
But it's very expensive, all this here, George. We'll find it very expensive.
Yes, I suppose we'll find it a bit more expensive.
Oh, Lord, yes.
How much do you think?
Oh, it's impossible to say until all the bills are in.
Yes, well, fortunately, Judge Brack has gotten me quite easy terms. Yes, that's what he wrote Hedda in his letters.
Yes, you mustn't worry yourself about that. I've also put down a mortgage to cover the carpets and the furniture.
Mortgage? For a security? Oh, dear Aunt Julia, how could you do something so crazy?
Oh, I saw nothing else to do.
Yes, but your pension, that security is all you have to live on.
Oh, now, don't make so much of it. It's just a formality. Judge Brack said so. Just a formality.
That's all very well, but still.
Oh, what now? You'll be drawing your own salary soon, and if we have to lay out a little bit at the start, why then that is just nothing more than a pleasure for us.
Aunt Julie, you never get tired of making sacrifices for me.
Oh, what other pleasure do I have in this world than smoothing a path for you, my dear boy, without mother or father to turn to? But now, George, you've come to the goal. Things might have looked black at the start, but thank heavens you've made it.
Yes, it's really remarkable how everything's worked out for the best.
And those who wanted to bar your way, George, those who stood against you, they've gone down. And the one most dangerous to you, he fell the farthest. And now he is lying there in the bed he made, poor misguided creature.
Have you heard any news on Eilert? Since I went away, I mean.
Only that he's supposed to have brought out a new book.
What's that? I wrote Love Book just recently, huh?
Well, now, it certainly can't amount to much considering everything, and you your new book. Now, when your new book comes out, that will be a different story. What will it be about?
Well, it is going to treat the domestic handicrafts of the Brabant in the Middle Ages.
Oh, wonderful. Imagine that you can write about such things.
Oh, yes. Well, it will be quite some time before the book comes out. I have a tremendous collection of material to organize.
Yes, collecting and organizing. You are not my brother's son for nothing.
And I am looking forward to getting started now, especially now that I have a nice, comfortable home of my own to work in.
Yes, and now that you have won her, the wife of your heart.
Oh, yes, Hedda, the most beautiful part of it all. Oh, but here she comes.
Good morning, Hedda. How good to see you.
Good morning, my dear Miss Tesman. Calling so early.
That is kind of you.
Did the bride sleep well in her new home?
Oh, yes, thanks. Quite adequately.
Oh, adequately. I like that, Hedda. You were sleeping like a stone when I got up.
Fortunately. But one has to grow accustomed to anything new, Miss Tesman, little by little. Oh, the maid has left the door open and the sunlight is just flooding in.
Well, closes.
No, dear, draw the curtains. It gives a softer light.
All right. There, Hedda, now you have shade and fresh air both.
Yes, we really do need some fresh air here with all these piles of flowers. Won't you sit down?
Oh, no, thank you. Now that I know that everything is fine, may goodness I have to go on home to Rita. She is lying there waiting for me. Poor thing.
Do give her my very, very best and tell her I'll be looking in on her later today.
Oh, you can be sure I will. Oh, but I almost forgot. I have something here for you.
What's that, Aunt Julia?
Oh, there.
You kept them. Oh, Hedda, that's really touching, eh?
What is it, dear?
My old bedroom slippers. My slippers!
Yes, I remember how often you spoke of them on the trip.
I've missed them so much, and now you can see them, Hedda.
Thanks, but I really don't care to.
Just think, Auntie Rena, as sick as she was, lay and embroidered them. Well, you can't imagine how many memories are bound up in them.
But not for me.
I think that Hedda is right, George.
Well, yes, I just thought that now that she's part of the family,
we are never going to manage with this maid, Tesman.
Why do you say that, dear?
She's a little cat lying out here on this chair.
But Hedda!
Well, somebody came in and saw it.
Hedda, that's Aunt Julie's hat!
Really?
Most certainly is, Mrs. Tesman. My hat? Not Berta's?
I really hadn't looked closely at it, Miss Tesman.
It's the first time I've had it on, the very first time.
And it's charming, too. Most attractive.
Oh, it's hardly all that, George. It's my parasol, for that's mine too. Oh, not Berta's.
Oh, new hats, new parasol, that I imagine.
Quite charming, really.
But Aunt Julie, before you go, I want you to get a good look at Hedda. See how charming she really is.
There's really nothing new to that, George. Hedda's been lovely all her life.
Yes, but have you noticed how plump and buxom she's grown? How much she's filled out on the trip?
Oh, do be quiet.
Filled out.
Well, I know it's hard to see in that dressing gown she's wearing, but I, who have had the opportunity.
Oh, you have no opportunity for anything.
Well, it must have been all that fresh mountain air down in the Tyrol.
I'm exactly as I was when we left.
Yes, that is your claim, but you certainly are not. Don't you agree, Aunt Julie?
Oh, Hedda, it's lovely, lovely, lovely. Oh, God bless and keep you, Hedda Tesman, for George's sake.
Let me go.
I won't let a day go by without looking in on the two of you.
Oh, yes, please do that.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
September now.
Yes, to think already we're in September.
Did Aunt Julie seem a bit strange to you today? A little formal, almost. I wonder what's bothering her.
I hardly know her at all. Isn't that how she usually is?
Oh, no, not like this today.
Do you think this thing with the hat upset her?
Oh, no. Maybe a little. In the moment, perhaps.
But really, what kind of manners had she to go throwing her hat about the drawing room? It just isn't proper.
Yes, well, you can be sure that Aunt Julie won't do that again.
Anyhow, I'll manage to smooth it over with her.
Yes, dear, I really wish you would.
And perhaps when you go to see them later on, you can ask her out for the evening.
Yes, I certainly will. And Hedda, there's something else you could do that would make Aunt Julie just terribly happy.
Oh?
If you could just bring yourself to speak warmly to her by her first name.
No, I have told you this once before. I will try to call her aunt. That should be enough.
Yes, well, I just thought that now that you're part of the family.
I really don't know.
Something the matter?
These flowers weren't here when we got in last time.
Oh, Aunt Julie must have brought them in this morning.
A visiting card says, "We'll stop by later today." Do you have any idea who this is from?
No, who?
It says, "Mrs. Elvsted."
No, really. A Sheriff Elvsted's wife. Miss Rising, she used to be.
Exactly. The one with the irritating hair she was always showing off. An old flame of yours, I've heard.
Oh, that wasn't for long. And it was before I knew you, dear. But to think that she's here in town.
Odd that she calls on us. I've hardly seen her since school.
Oh, yes, me too. I haven't seen her since God knows when. I wonder how she can stand to live in such an out-of-the-way place.
Isn't it somewhere up near there that even either clubboard lives?
Yes, it's somewhere right around there.
She's back again, ma'am. The lady that stopped by and left the flowers an hour ago. The ones right in front of you, ma'am.
Oh, is she? Ask her to come in. Good morning, my dear Mrs. Elmstead. How delightful to see you again.
Yes, it is a very long time since we last met.
Or since we last met.
Thank you for the beautiful flowers.
Oh, that's nothing. I would have come straight out here yesterday afternoon, but then I heard you weren't at home.
Did you just now get to town then?
Oh, I got in yesterday toward noon. I was in desperation when I heard you weren't at home.
Desperation? Why?
But my dear Mrs. Elves, Mrs. Rice, Mrs.
You're not
Elves
in some kind of trouble.
Oh, well, yes, I am. And I don't know another living soul down here that I could turn to.
Well, come then. Let's sit here on the sofa.
Oh, I can't sit down. I'm really much too on edge.
Why, of course you can. Come here.
Well, what is it, Mrs. Elvsted?
Has anything particular happened at home?
Yes, that's both it and not it. Oh, I do want so much that you don't misunderstand.
Then the best thing, Mrs. Elvsted, is simply to speak your mind.
Because I suppose that's what you've come here to do.
Yes, yes, that's why. Well then, I have to tell you, if you don't already know, that Eilert Loveborg is also in town.
Loveborg?
What's that? Eilert Loveborg here in town? Oh, Hedda, just think.
Good Lord, I can hear.
Yes. He's been back all of a week's time now. A whole week, alone, in this big city, and with all the bad company that's around.
But my dear girl, what does he have to do with you?
He was the children's tutor.
Your children's?
My husband's, I have none.
Your stepchildren's, then?
Yes.
But my dear Mrs. Elvsted, was he, well, I'm not really sure exactly how to put this, sufficiently responsible in his habits for such a position?
In the last 2 years, there wasn't a word to be said against him.
Not a word, oh, just think.
I heard it.
Not even a murmur. I can assure you nothing. But anyways, now that I know he's here in this big town and with so much money in his hands, well, I'm just frightened to death for him.
Then why didn't he stay where he was? Up there, or with you and your husband?
Well, after the book came out, he just couldn't rest content with us.
Yes, Aunt Julie said he had just come out with a new book.
Yes, a great new book on the course of civilization in all its stages. It's been out 2 weeks' time now, and it's been bought and read so much, and it's made tremendous stir.
Well, it must be something he's had lying around from better days, eh?
Years back, you mean?
I suppose.
Why, no, he's written it all up there with us in this past year.
How marvelous! Hedda, just think.
Yes, if only it could go on like this.
Have you seen him here in town?
No, I had such trouble finding out his address, but this morning I got it at last.
I must say, it seems rather odd of your husband.
Of my husband? What?
To send you to town on this sort of errand instead of coming to look after his friend himself.
No, my husband hasn't the time for such things. And then I had some shopping to do.
Oh, that's different.
Oh, Mr. Tesla. Be good to either Glubborg if he comes to you, and I'm sure he will. You know, you were such good friends in the old days, and you're doing the same type of work, the same type of research, from what I can gather.
Yes, well, we were once at any rate.
Yes, and that's why I'm asking you, please, you too, to keep an eye on him. Oh, you will do that for me, Mr. Tesman. Promise me that.
Miss Rising.
Elfstead.
I'll only be too glad to look after either Glubborg. You can depend on that.
Kind of you. Many, many thanks. He means so much to my husband, you know.
You ought to write him, dear. He might not come by on his own.
Yes, dear, that probably would be best, wouldn't it?
Yes, and the sooner the better. Right away, I'd say.
Oh, yes, I'll write him right this moment.
Yes, you could.
Do you have an address?
Yes.
Oh, good. yes, well then. Oh, my slippers!
Make it a warm, friendly letter, nice and long, too.
Yes, of course, dear.
Oh, but please, not a word that I asked you to.
Oh, well, of course not. That goes without saying, eh?
How's that? Now we've killed two birds with one stone.
What do you mean?
Didn't you see that I wanted him out of the room?
Yes, to write the letter.
Yes, but also to talk with you alone.
About this same thing?
Precisely.
Oh, but Mrs. Tesman, there's really nothing more to say.
Oh, yes, there is. There's a good deal more. I can see that. Come, sit here. Let's talk openly now, the two of us.
Oh, but Mrs. Tesman, dear, I really was just planning.
Oh, you can't be in such a rush. There. Tell me a little about how things are going at home.
Oh, well, that's the last thing I'd ever want to discuss.
Oh, with me, dear? After all, we were in school together.
Yes, but you were a class ahead of me. Oh, I was terribly afraid of you then.
Afraid of me?
Yes, because whenever we met on the stairs, you would always pull my hair.
Did I really?
Yes. And one time you said you would burn it off.
Oh, that was just foolish talk, you know.
Yes, but I was so stupid then. And anyway, since then, we've drifted so far, far apart. You know, we've moved in such different circles.
Well, let us try now to come closer together again. After all, in school, we were such good friends. We used to call each other by our first names.
No, I'm sure you're mistaken.
No, I couldn't be. I remember it clearly. And that's why now we must be perfectly open, just as we were. There. You have to call me Hedda.
Oh, you're so good and kind. It's not at all what I'm used to.
Oh, there, there. I'm going to call you my own dear Thora.
Oh, my name is Taya.
Of course not. I meant Taya. So, you're not much used to goodness or kindness, Taya, in your own home?
If only I had a home, but I don't. I never have.
I knew it must have been something like that.
Yes. Yes.
I can't quite remember now, but wasn't it as a housekeeper that you first came up to the Elfsteads?
Oh, as a governess, actually, but his wife, his first wife, she was an invalid and she kept mostly to her bed, so I had to take care of the house, too.
But eventually you became mistress of the house yourself.
Yes, I did.
About how long ago was that?
That I was married?
Yes.
Well, it's been 5 years now.
Right, must be.
These 5 years, if you only knew Mrs. Tesman.
Mrs. Tesman! Now, Taya.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'll try. If you only knew Hedda.
And Ida Glubborg has lived up there about 3 years, too, hasn't he?
Ida Glubborg?
Yes.
Why, yes, he has.
Did you know him here in town?
Oh, hardly at all. By name, of course, but...
But up there, I suppose he'd visit you both.
Well, he came to see us every day. He was tutoring the children, because in the long run, you know, I can do it all by
You must tell me everything, just as it is.
Well, you have to ask the questions.
What kind of man is your husband, Taya? I mean, you know, to be with. Is he good to you?
He believes he does everything for the best.
I only think he must be much too old for you. More than 20 years older, isn't he?
That's true. Along with everything else, I just can't stand him. We haven't had a single thought in common, he and I. Nothing at all.
Yes, but doesn't he care for you all the same in his own way?
I don't know how he feels. I'm no more than useful to him. And then it doesn't cost much to keep me. I'm inexpensive.
Well, that's stupid of you.
Well, it can't be otherwise. Not with him. He really doesn't care for anyone but himself. And maybe a little for the children.
And for Eiler Glovborg, Taya.
Eiler Glovborg? Why do you think so?
Well, it seems to me to send you to town to look after him. Besides, it's what you told my husband.
Really? Why, yes, I suppose I did. No, I might as well tell you here and now. It's bound to come out in time.
But my dear Taya.
All right, then. My husband never knew I was coming here.
What? He never knew?
No, of course not. And anyways, he wasn't at home, off traveling somewhere. I couldn't bear it any longer, Hedda. I would have been so alone up there now.
Well, what then?
Well, then I packed a few of my things together without saying a word and slipped away from the house.
Right then and there.
And took a train straight into town.
But my dearest girl, that you could dare to do such a thing.
What else could I possibly?
What are you going to say to your husband when you go back home?
Back to him?
Yes, of course.
I'm never going back to him.
You mean you've left in dead earnest for good?
There wasn't anything else to do.
But to go away so openly.
Well, you can't keep a thing like that secret.
But what do you think people will say about you, Taya?
God knows, they'll say what they please. I only did what I had to do.
What do you plan on now? What kind of work?
Oh, I don't know what I'll do. I only know that I have to live here where Eiler Glovborg is if I'm going to live at all.
How did this friendship between you and Eiler Glovborg come about?
Oh, it happened little by little. I've got some kind of power almost over him.
Really?
Yes, he dropped all of his old habits. And not because I asked him to. I never dared to do that, but he could tell they upset. Dropped them.
Oh, my dear Taya, it is just as they say, you have rehabilitated him.
Well, he says so at any rate, and he, on his part, he has made a real human being out of me. Taught me to think and understand so many things.
You mean he tutored you also?
No, not exactly, but he would talk to me. Talk endlessly about one thing after another. And then came the wonderful, happy time when I could share in his work, when I could help him.
Could you really?
Oh, yes. Anytime he would write anything, we would always work on it together.
Like two true companions.
Companions. Do you know what, Hedda? That is exactly what he said. I ought to feel so happy, but I can't. I don't know if it's going to last.
You're no more sure of him than that?
There's a woman's shadow between Eiler Glovborg and me.
Who might that be?
I don't know. Someone out of his past, someone he's never really forgotten.
Well, what has he said about this?
It was just once and vaguely that he touched on it.
Well, what did he say?
He said that when they broke things off, she was going to shoot him with a pistol.
That's nonsense. Nobody behaves that way around here.
No, and that's why I think it must have been that red-headed singer that at one time...
Yes, quite likely.
But you know what I've heard, Hedda? This singer, she's back in town again, and God just has me out of my mind.
Shh, Tesman is coming. But let's keep all of this just between us.
Oh, yes, heaven's gate.
There was a letter signed and sealed.
That's fine. Mrs. Elstead was just leaving. Oh, wait, dear, I'll take you through the garden.
Hedda, do you think maybe Bert could look after this?
Yes, I will ask you to. Yes, ask the judge to come in. Bertha, put this in the mail.
May one dare to call so early?
Of course one may.
You're always welcome here. Judge, Miss Reiser.
I'm delighted.
Really is a treat to see you by daylight, Judge.
Oh, you find me changed.
A bit.
Judge, what do you have to say now for Hedda, huh? Doesn't she look flourish?
Oh, leave me out of it. You might thank Judge for all the trouble he's got.
Nonsense, it was a pleasure.
Yes, you're a true friend. Oh, but here's Taya just standing there, aching to get away. Excuse me, Judge, I'll be right back.
So your wife is fairly well satisfied, then?
Oh, yes, we can't thank you enough. I gather there's a little rearrangement needed here and there, and one or two items are lacking. We still have to pick up a couple minor items.
Really?
Oh, yes, but that's nothing for you to worry about, Judge. Hedda said she'd pick those things up herself. But here, let's sit and chat for a little while, eh?
Thanks. Just for a moment. There is something I would like to discuss with you, Desmond.
Oh? I see. It's the serious part of the banquet we've come to.
Well, as far as money matters go, there's no great rush. Although, I must say, I do wish we'd managed things a bit more economically.
That was impossible, Judge. Just think of Hedda. You who know her so well. I couldn't have her just living like a grocer's wife.
No, that's the trouble, exactly.
And fortunately, I can't be long now before my appointment comes through.
Well, you know. These things can often hang fire.
Have you heard something further?
Nothing really definite, but incidentally, I do have one piece of news for you, Desmond.
Oh?
Your old friend, Eilert Loveborg, is back in town.
Yes, I know already.
You do? How did you hear?
Well, she told us, the woman that left with Hedda.
I see. What was her name again? I didn't quite catch it.
Mrs. Elfstead.
Ah, yes. Sheriff Elfstead's wife. It's up near them he's been staying.
How marvelous to hear that he's completely stable again.
Yes, that's what they claim.
But he's come out with this new book.
Oh, yes.
And it's created a bit of a stir.
An extraordinary sensation.
Oh, how marvelous. Him with all his remarkable talents. And I was so very certain he had really gone down for good.
That's what everyone thought.
Only what's going to become of him now? How's he going to make a living?
Desmond always goes around worrying about how people are going to make a living.
My dear, it's poor Eilert Loveborg we're talking of.
Oh, really? What's the matter with him?
Well, I was just saying he must have gone through his inheritance long ago, and he can't come out with a new book every year, so I was just asking, really, what's going to become of him?
Perhaps I can shed some light on that.
Oh?
You must remember, he does have relatives with a great deal of influence.
Yes, but they wash their hands of him altogether.
They used to call him the family's white hope.
Used to, but he went and spoiled that all himself.
Who knows? He's been rehabilitated up at the Elfsteads.
And then this new book that he's published.
Yes, well, let's hope they really do help him one way or another. Hedda, I wrote him and asked him to come by this evening.
My dear fellow! You're coming to my stag party this evening, remember? You promised last night out on the pier.
Had you forgotten?
Yes, I absolutely had.
And for that matter, you can rest assured he'd never come.
Why do you say that, Judge?
My dear Tesman, and you too, Mrs. Tesman, I can't in all conscience let you go on any further without knowing something that...
Something that involves Eilert.
Both you and him.
Well, tell us what it is.
You must be prepared that your appointment may not come through as quickly as you've wished or expected.
Has something gone wrong?
It may turn out there'll have to be a competition for the post.
A competition? Oh, Hedda, imagine!
Not there now, you see.
What with who? Oh, you can't mean.
Yes, exactly. With Eilert Loveborg.
No, that's unthinkable, that's impossible, eh?
But it may come about, all the same.
No, but Judge, that would just be terribly inconsiderate toward me. Yes, because I'm a married man now. Hedda and I be married on my prospects. We set up house, we went into debt, we borrowed money from Aunt Julie all because of that job. It was as good as promised to me, eh?
Easy now. I'm sure you'll get the appointment, but you will have to compete for it.
Just think, Tesman, it will be kind of like a championship match.
Yes, but dear, how can you take it so calmly?
I'm not the least bit calm. I can't wait to see how it turns out.
At any rate, Mrs. Tesman, it is well that you know now how things stand. I mean, with regard to these little purchases I hear you've been threatening to make.
This business can't change anything.
I see. Well, that is another matter. Goodbye. When I go out on my afternoon walk, I will stop by and fetch you.
Yes, please do. I don't know where I'm at.
Goodbye, Judge. Come again soon.
Many thanks. Goodbye now.
Goodbye. Excuse me. Oh, Hedda. One shouldn't go off and get lost in daydreams, huh?
Do you do that?
Well, there's no use denying it. Who is living in dreams to go off and get married and set up house based on nothing but expectations?
Yes, perhaps you're right about that.
Yes, well, at least now we have a nice, comfortable home of our own. The house we both wanted. The house we both fell in love with, I could almost say.
It was part of our bargain that we would live in society, that we would keep a great house.
Oh, yes, of course. Oh, how I look forward to seeing you play hostess in our small select circle of friends. Yes, well, for the time being, the two of us will just have to get on by ourselves. Maybe have Aunt Julie here every now and then. Oh, well, for you, I wanted things so utterly different.
Naturally, this means I can't have a butler now.
Butler? Good Lord, no! We can't even talk about that.
And the riding horse I was supposed to have.
Riding horses?
I suppose I can't think about that either.
Well, no, that's obvious, eh?
Well, at least I still have one thing left to amuse myself with.
Thank God for that. What is it, Hedda?
My pistols, George.
Your pistols?
General Gobbler's pistols.
Oh, no, no, Hedda, dear, don't touch those dangerous things for my sake, eh?
This one, I know it well. Where's the case? There. We'll have no more of that kind of fun today.
What do you expect me to do with myself?
Haven't you had any visitors?
Not a single one. All of our set are still in the country, I guess.
And Tenzin isn't home either.
Oh no, he went over to his aunt's right after lunch. He didn't expect you so soon.
I should have realized. That was stupid of me.
Why stupid?
Because in that case, I would have stopped by a bit earlier.
Oh, well, then you'd have found no one here at all. I've been in my room dressing since lunch.
And there's not the least little crack in the door we could confer through.
You forgot to arrange it.
Also stupid of me.
Well, we'll just have to sit down here and wait. Tesman won't be back for a while.
Don't worry. I can be patient. Then let's have a nice little cozy chat, Mrs. Hedda.
Doesn't it seem like a whole eternity since the last time we two spoke together? I mean, a few words last night and this morning, but they hardly count.
You mean like this, between ourselves, just the two of us?
Well, more or less.
There wasn't a day that I didn't wish you were home again.
Oh, I was wishing exactly the same.
Really? You, Mrs. Tesman, I thought you were having such a marvelous time.
Oh, you
can
imagine.
Well, that's what Tesman always wrote.
Oh, him. There's nothing he likes better than grubbing around old libraries and copying out parchment.
Yes, but after all, it is his calling in life, in good part anyway.
Yes, that's true. So there's nothing wrong with it, but what about me? Judge, I have been so dreadfully bored.
Do you really mean that, in all seriousness?
Just imagine, to go for a whole 6 months without anyone to talk to from our circle. No one that one could talk to about our kind of things.
Yes, I suppose that would bother me too.
And then the worst part of it all.
Well?
To be everlastingly together with one and the same person.
Morning, noon, and night, yes, at every conceivable hour.
I said everlastingly.
All right. But with our good friend, Tesman, I really would have thought...
My dear Judge, Tesman is a specialist.
Undeniably.
And specialists are not at all amusing to travel with, not in the long run, anyway.
Not even the specialist that one loves.
Ugh, don't use that syrupy word.
What is that, Mrs. Hedda?
Well, you try it. You try listening to the history of civilization, morning, noon...
Everlasting.
Yes, yes. And then all this business about domestic crafts in the Middle Ages, it just really is too revolting.
But tell me, I can't see how it ever came about that...
That George Tesman and I could make a match.
All right, let's put it that way.
I really had danced myself out, Judge. My time was up. I hate to say it or think it either, but...
You certainly have no reason to.
No reason to. And Tesman... He is, after all, a thoroughly acceptable choice.
Acceptable and dependable, beyond a doubt.
And I don't find anything especially ridiculous about him, do you?
Ridiculous? No, I wouldn't say that.
Well, anyway, he spends a good deal of time on his research, and there's a chance, in time, he could make something of himself.
I thought you believed, like everyone else, he was going to be quite famous someday.
Yes. He kept pressing and pleading to be allowed to take care of me. I didn't see why I ought to resist.
No, from that point of view, certainly not.
It was certainly more than my other admirers were willing to do for me, Judge.
Well, I can't exactly speak for all the others, but as far as I'm concerned, you know that I've always cherished a certain respect for the marriage bond, generally speaking. That is.
I never held out any hopes for you, Judge.
Oh. All I want is to have a warm circle of intimate friends where I can be of use one way or another, with the freedom to come and go as a trusted friend.
Of the man of the house, you mean?
Frankly, I prefer the lady. But the man, too, of course, in his place. That sort of, shall we say, triangular arrangement. You can't imagine how satisfying it can be all the way around.
Yes. You don't know how many times I'd wished for some third person on that trip. Oh, those endless tete-a-tetes and railway compartments.
Fortunately, the wedding trip is over now.
The trip will go on and on. We have just come to one stop on the line.
Well, then what you do is jump out and stretch yourself a little, Mrs. Hedda.
I'll never jump out.
Never?
No. Because there's always someone on the platform who...
Who looks at your legs, is that it?
Precisely.
Yes, but after...
I'm not interested. I'd rather keep my seat right here where I am, tete-a-tete.
Well, but suppose a third person came on board and joined the couple.
Oh, well, that's entirely different.
A trusted friend who understands...
And can talk about all kinds of lively things.
Who's not in the least a specialist.
Yes, that would be a relief.
Ah, the triangle is complete.
And the train goes on.
It's hot work carrying all these. Oh, I'm actually sweating, Hedda. What's this? Judge Brack, is that you?
Yes, I came in through the garden.
Oh...
What are all those books?
They are new publications in my special field.
Your special field?
Of course. Books in his special field, Mrs. Tesman.
You need still more books in your special field?
Oh, one can never have too many. You have to keep up with what's been written and published.
Yes, I suppose so.
But look, I picked up Eilert's new book also. Maybe you'd like to read it?
No, perhaps maybe later.
Well, I skimmed part of it on the way over here.
And what do you think of it as a specialist?
Well, I think it's remarkable how well it holds up. He has never written anything like this before. But I can't wait to get these back into the study and to cut up the pages. Mm. We're in no great rush, are we, Judge?
Oh, no, we have plenty of time.
Oh, great. Then I will be at my leisure. Incidentally, Hedda, Aunt Julie won't be able to see you this evening.
She won't. I suppose it's this thing with the hat.
Oh, no, Hedda, dear, how could you think that? No, it's Auntie Rena. She's very ill.
She always is.
Yes, but today she really took a turn for the worse.
Oh, then it only makes sense for her sister to stay with her. I shall have to bear with it.
Yes, but you can't imagine how delighted she was all the same, because she filled out so nicely on the trip.
Oh, these eternal odds.
What?
Nothing.
All right.
What is all this about a hat?
Oh, it's just something that happened with Miss Tesman this morning. She left her hat over here on this chair, and I pretended I thought it was the maid's.
My dear Miss Hedda, how could you do that, hurt that nice old lady?
It's just these things, they come over me suddenly, and I don't know how to hold back. Oh. I don't know myself how to explain it.
You're not really happy, that's the heart of it.
And I don't know why I ought to be happy. Perhaps you can tell me why?
Well, yes. Among other things, because you've gotten just the house you've always wanted.
You believe that story, too?
You mean there's nothing to it?
There's something to it.
Well?
There's this much to it. That I used George Tesman as an escort home from parties last summer?
Yes, unfortunately, I was headed quite a different way.
How true. Yes, you went several different ways last summer.
For shame, Mrs. Hedda! So you and Tesman.
Yes, so one evening we walked past this place, and poor Tesman was writhing in torment because he couldn't think of anything to say, and I felt sorry that a man of such learning...
Did you?
I honestly did. So I came out with some rash remark about this lovely house being where I'd always wanted to live.
No more than that.
No more that evening.
Yes, but afterward.
Yes, my rashness had its consequences, Judge.
I'm afraid our rashness all too often does, Mrs. Hedda.
Thanks. But don't you see, it was this passion for the Falk Mansion that drew George Tesman and me together. It was no more than that that brought on our engagement and the marriage and the wedding trip and everything else. Oh yes, Judge, I was going to say you made your bed and then you lie in it.
That is priceless. So you actually couldn't care less about any of this?
Oh, God knows, not in the least.
Look, even now that we've gotten it furnished, a bit cozier for you here.
Yeah, all the rooms seem to smell of lavender and dried roses. But maybe that was a scent brought in by Aunt Julie.
No, I think that was a bequest of the late Mrs. Falk.
Yes, there's something in it of the odor of death. Like a corsage the day after the dance. Oh, Judge, you don't know how I'm going to bore myself here.
Couldn't you find some goal in life to work towards? Others do, Mrs. Hedda.
A goal that would really absorb me?
Preferably, yes.
God only knows what that could be. I sometimes wonder if that's impossible, too.
Who knows? Tell me.
I was thinking, if I could get Tesman into politics...
Tesman! No. I can assure you, politics is absolutely out of his line.
No, I can believe you, but still, I was thinking, if I could get him into it...
Yes, but what satisfaction would you have in that? If he can't succeed, why push him in that direction?
Because I've told you I'm bored. You really think it's out of the question that he could be a cabinet minister?
Well, you see, Mrs. Hedda, in
anything like that, he would have to be fairly wealthy to start.
Ah, there it is. It's this tight little world I stumbled into. That's what makes life so miserable, so utterly ludicrous, because that is what it is.
I'd say the fault lies elsewhere.
Where?
You've never experienced anything that's really stirred you.
Anything serious, you mean?
Well, you can call it that if you like. But perhaps now it's on the way.
Oh, you mean all this business about Tasman's professorship? That's his problem. I'm not going to give it a single thought.
No, that isn't. Never mind. But suppose you were to be confronted now by what, in rather elegant language, is called your most solemn responsibility. A new responsibility, Mrs. Hedda.
Be quiet. You'll never see me like that.
We'll discuss it again in a year's time at the latest.
I have no talent for such things, Judge. I won't have responsibilities.
Don't you think you have a talent for what almost every woman claims to be the...
I told you, be quiet! I often think I have a talent for only one thing in this world.
And what, may I ask, is that?
Boring myself to death, and that's the truth. See what I mean? Here comes the professor.
Hedda, dear, have you heard any news from either yet?
No.
Oh, well then he'll be by shortly, I'm sure of it.
Do you really believe he'll come?
Yes, I really do, because I'm sure they're nothing but rumors that you told us this morning. Yes, or at least Aunt Julie seems to think he wouldn't stand in my way again.
So everything is well and good, then.
Yes, but I really would like to wait for him just as long as possible.
Yes, there's no one due at my place until 7 or 7:30. We have plenty of time.
Well, then we can sit and keep Hedda company and see what turns up, eh?
And if worse comes to worse, Mr. Loveborn can always stay and have supper with me.
Please, Mrs. Tesman, what do you mean by worse in this case?
If he won't go with you and Tesman.
But dear, are you sure that's quite right? Remember that Aunt Julie isn't coming by this evening.
No, but Mrs. Elvsted is. The three of us can have tea together.
Oh, Mrs. Elvsted, that's all right.
And perhaps that may be the soundest plan for him as well.
Why?
Really, Mrs. Tesman, you've made enough pointed remarks about my little bachelor parties. You've always said they're only fit for men of the strictest principles.
Well, surely Mr. Loveborg is a man of strict principle. After all, over...
Gentlemen here to see you?
Yes, send him in.
Well, that's Eiler Loveborg, if ever I saw him. It's been some time.
Thanks for your letter, George. And may I shake hands with you too, Mrs. Tesman?
Glad to see you, Mr. Loveborg. I don't know if you two gentlemen...
Judge Bragg, I believe.
Of course. It's been some years.
And now, Eiler, make yourself at home completely, right, Hedda dear? I understand you'll be settling down in town again.
Oh, I plan to.
Oh, well, that makes sense. Listen, I bought your new book, but I haven't had time to read it yet.
You can save yourself the bother.
Well, why do you say that?
There's very little to it.
Oh, imagine that you could say something like that.
But it's won such high praise, I hear.
Well, that's exactly what I wanted. So I wrote a book everyone could agree with.
Very sad.
But my dear Eiler,
well, because now I want to build up my position again. Make a fresh start.
Yes, I suppose that is what you want.
But when this comes out, George Tesman, you will have to read it. Because this is the real book, the one that speaks for my true self.
And what kind of book is that?
It's the sequel.
The sequel to what?
To the book.
The one just out.
Of course.
But Eiler, that book comes right up to our own time.
Yes, it does, and this one deals with the future.
The future? Well, there's nothing at all we know about that.
True, but there are one or two things worth saying all the same.
But this,
take a look.
This is in your handwriting.
I dictated it. It's divided into two sections. The first part discusses the forces shaping the civilization of the future. And then the second part, here, suggests what lines of development it's likely to take.
Well, that's really remarkable. It never would have occurred to me to write anything like that.
No, of course not.
I brought it along because I thought I might read you a bit of it this evening.
Eiler, that would be wonderful, but this evening, and I'm not really sure that's possible.
Well, some other time then. There's no hurry.
I should explain. There's a little party at my place this evening, mostly for Tesman, you understand.
Oh, then I won't stay.
You
No, listen, won't you give me the pleasure of having you join us?
No, I can't, thanks.
Nonsense, do that. We'll be a small, select group, and you can bet we'll have it lively, as Mrs. Tesman puts it.
I don't doubt it, but nevertheless.
You could bring your manuscript and read some to Tesman there at my place. I have plenty of rooms.
Oh, yes, I learned you could do that, couldn't you?
But my dear, if Mr. Loveboard doesn't want to, I'm sure Mr. Loveboard would rather stay here and have supper with me.
With you, Mrs. Tesman.
And with Mrs. Elmstead.
Ah, I saw her for a moment this afternoon.
Did you? Well, she'll be here soon, so it's almost essential for you to stay, or she'll have no one to walk her home.
Yes, that is true. Thank you, Mrs. Tesman. I'll be staying then.
Let me just tell the maid.
Now, Eilert, tell me, this new material on the future, is this what you're going to be lecturing on?
Yes.
Because I heard at the bookstore that you're going to be getting a lecture series
here
this
autumn. Well, I intend to. I hope you won't be offended.
Oh, no, of course not.
Because I can easily see how this makes things rather difficult for you.
Well, I would hardly expect for my sake that you would...
I'm going to wait till you have your appointment.
You'll wait? Okay, yes, well, then you're not competing for it.
No, I only want to win in the eyes of the world.
Well then, Aunt Julie was right. Oh, Hedda, just think. Eilert Loveboard won't stand in our way.
Our way? Leave me out of it.
Well, what do you have to say to all this, Judge, huh?
Me, well, victory and honor, after all, are very sweet.
Yes, but still.
You look as if you've been struck by lightning.
Yes, something of the kind, I suppose.
That's because a thunderstorm just passed over us, Mrs. Desmond.
Oh, won't you gentlemen have a nice glass of cold punch?
A parting cup, eh? That's not such a bad idea.
Marvelous idea, Hedda. Simply marvelous. Oh, the way I feel now with this weight lifted off my mind.
You too, Mr. Loveboard.
No, thank you. Not for me.
Good Lord. Cold punch. It isn't poison, you know.
Perhaps not for everyone.
I'll keep Mr. Loveboard company a while.
Oh, yes, you do that, dear.
I can show you some photographs if you'd like. Tesman and I traveled through the Tyrol on our way home. This here is a view of the Ortler Group, Mr. Loveboard. Tesman has labeled them underneath the Ortler Group near Marin.
Hedda Gabler.
Shh.
Hedda Gabler.
Yes, that used to be my name in those days when we two knew each other.
And from now on, for the rest of my life, I have to teach myself not to say Hedda Gabler.
Yes, you have to, and you better start practicing it, I think. The sooner the better.
And Hedda Gabler's married. George Tesman.
Yes, that's how it goes.
Oh, Hedda, how would you throw yourself away like that?
All right, no more of that.
What do you mean?
This one was taken by the Val d'Ampezzo. Just look at the peaks of those mountains. What were these marvelous mountains called, dear?
Those are the Dolomites.
Yes, those are the Dolomites, Mr. Loveboard.
Oh, Hedda, dear, I was only wondering if I shouldn't bring out some punch anyway, for you at least.
Oh, yes, thanks. And a couple of petit fours?
No cigarettes?
No.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Go and do such a thing.
If you keep on saying Hedda like that to me, I won't talk to you.
Can't I say Hedda, even when we're alone?
You can think it, but you mustn't say it like that.
I understand. It offends your love for George Tesman.
Love? You are absurd.
Then you don't love him.
I don't expect to be unfaithful either. I won't be having any of that.
Just answer me one thing, Hedda.
Look out! Here come the goodies!
Why do you do the serving?
Oh, because I find it so much fun to wait on you, Hedda.
Yes, but now you've poured out two glasses, and Mr. Loveboard doesn't want...
Oh, yes, but Mrs. Elfstead will be by later.
Mrs. Elfstead.
Or have you forgotten about her?
We've just been so caught up in these. Do you remember this little village?
Oh, yes, that was just below Brenner's Pass. It was there that we stayed overnight, and
then all those lively summer people.
Oh, yes. Oh, Eilert, if we could have had you there with us. My.
Just answer me one thing.
Yes?
Was there no love with respect to me either? Not a spark, not a glimmer?
two true companions, two very close friends. You always were so open with me.
You wanted it that way.
Yes. Looking back on it, there really was something beautiful and fascinating and daring, it seems to me, about our secret closeness, our companionship that no one, not a soul, suspected.
Yes, Hedda, that's true, wasn't there? When I'd come over to your father's in the afternoon, and the general sat by the window reading his papers with his back to us.
We'd sit on the corner sofa.
Always with the same illustrated magazine in front of us.
Yes, for the lack of an album.
Yes, Hedda, and the confessions I used to make. Telling you things about myself that no one else knew of, that not a soul suspected about the way I'd go out, the drinking, the madness that went on day and night for days at a time. What power was it in you, Hedda, that made me tell you such things?
You think it was some kind of power in me?
Well, how else can I explain it? With all those devious questions you'd ask me.
That you understood so remarkably well.
To think you could sit there and ask such questions so boldly.
Deviously, please.
Yes, but boldly all the same. Interrogating me about all kind of things.
And to think you could answer, Mr. Lovegore.
Yes, and that's exactly what I don't understand now looking back. But tell me, Hedda, the root of that bond between us, wasn't it love? Didn't you feel on your part as if you wanted to cleanse and absolve me when I brought those confessions to you? Wasn't that it?
No, not quite.
What made you do it?
Do you find it so hard to believe that a young girl, if there's no chance of anyone knowing...
Yes?
She'd like some glimpse of a world that...
That?
That she's forbidden to know anything about.
So that was it?
Partly that, I guess.
Companionship and a thirst for life, but... Tell me then, why couldn't it have gone on?
Well, that was your fault.
You broke it off.
Yes, but only when that closeness of ours threatened to grow more serious. Shame on you, Eilert Loveborg. How could you violate my trust when I had been so bold in my friendship?
Why didn't you say? Why didn't you shoot me down?
I am much too afraid of a scandal.
Yes, Hedda, you're a coward, Bart.
A terrible coward. But that was lucky for you. And now you're so nicely consoled up at the Elmstead.
Oh, I know what Tay has been telling you.
Perhaps you've been telling her all about us?
Not a word. Too stupid for that sort of thing.
Stupid?
When it comes to those things, she's stupid.
And I'm a coward. But now there is something I can tell you.
What?
When I didn't shoot you?
Yes.
That wasn't my worst cowardice that night.
Oh, Hedda Gabler, now I begin to see it. The hidden reason why we've been so close, you and I. There's a hunger for life in you.
Careful, that's no way to think. Taya, my dear, please come in. Taya, my sweet, I thought you were never coming.
Yes, perhaps I ought to go in and talk with your husband a bit.
Oh, nonsense, they're leaving soon.
Well, they're leaving?
Yes, for a drinking party.
But you're not.
No.
Mr. Loveborg is staying with us.
Oh, so good to be here.
No, but come closer to me. I want to be in the middle.
Anyway, please.
Isn't she lovely to look at?
Only to look at?
Yes, because we two, she and I, we really are true companions. We trust each other completely. We can talk things out together without any reservations.
Never anything devious, Mr. Loveborg.
Well.
Oh, Hedda, you don't know how happy I am to think he says I've inspired him.
Really, dear, did he say that?
Yeah, and then the courage she has, Mrs. Tesman, when it's put to the test.
Goodness me. Courage.
Yes, courage. If one only had that.
Then what?
Life might still be bearable. Taya, won't you have a nice glass of cold punch?
No, thank you. I never drink that sort of thing.
Well, then you, Mr. Loveborg.
No, thanks. Not for me either.
No, not for him either.
But if I insist?
Makes no difference.
Poor me, that I have no power over you after all.
Not in that area.
But really, I think you ought to for your own sake.
Oh.
Why do you think so?
Or to be more exact, for others' sakes.
Oh?
Yes, otherwise people might get the idea that you're not very bold at heart, that you're not really sure of yourself at all.
Hedda, don't.
People can think whatever they want for all I care.
Yes, that's right.
I saw it so clearly at Judge Brack a moment ago.
What did you see?
The contempt in his smile when you wouldn't dare join them for a drink.
Wouldn't dare? Obviously, I'd rather stay here and talk with you.
Yes, that's only reasonable, Hedda.
Yes. But how could Judge Brack know that? Besides, I saw him smile and glance at Tesman when you couldn't bring yourself to go to their wretched little party.
Couldn't? Are you saying I couldn't?
I'm not. But that's the way Judge Brack sees it.
here with you and Taya.
Yes, you can be sure he is, Hedda.
I see. Firm as a rock. True to principle to the end of time there. That is what a man ought to be. Now, didn't I tell you that when you came here so distraught this morning?
Distraught?
Yes, Hedda. See for yourself. There's no need to go around so deathly afraid. There. Now we can enjoy ourselves.
What is all this, Mrs. Tesman?
Hedda,
what are you saying? Now you do have that disgusting judge is listening to you.
So deathly afraid for my sake?
Oh, Hedda, you've made me so miserable.
So that's how completely you trusted me?
My dearest, if you will only listen.
To your health, Taya.
Hedda, how could you want such a thing?
Want it? Are you crazy?
Yeah, and your health too, Mrs. Tesman. Thanks for the truth. Long live the truth.
All right. Remember, you're going to a party.
No.
They are listening to you.
You know, Taya, tell me, honestly.
Yes.
Did your husband know you followed me?
Listen.
Did you have it arranged, you and he, that you'd come down to town and spy on me? Or perhaps he got you to do it himself. Yes, I'm sure he knew you back to the officer. Maybe Miss Mahan had a card. Was that it? Scold to the old church, too.
All right, that's enough. Remember, you're giving a reading for Tesman.
That was stupid of me, Taya. No, I mean taking it like that. Don't be angry with me, my dearest. You'll see, you and all the others, that if I stumbled and fell, I'm back on my feet again. Now, with your help, Taya.
Thank God.
Well, Mrs. Tesman, our time is up.
I suppose it is.
And mine too, Judge.
They're listening to you.
Are you kind enough to ask me around?
Then you are coming after all.
Yes, thank you.
I am delighted.
And I wanted to show you one or two things before I turn this in.
Well, how exciting. Only, Hedda dear, how will Mrs. Elvstead be getting home?
No, we'll hit on something. Well,
Mrs. Elvstead, don't worry. I'll stop back and fetch her. Say about 10 o'clock, Mrs. Tesman, will that do?
That will do quite nicely.
Well, then everything's all set. Only, Hedda dear, you mustn't expect me home that early.
Oh, dear. You stay as long, just as long as you want.
Mr. Lovborn, I'll be waiting here.
Yes, Hedda.
Good night, until you come.
Yes, I understand.
Well, gentlemen, the excursion train is leaving. I do hope it will be lively, as a certain fair lady puts it.
If only that fair lady could be there, invisible.
Why invisible?
Some of your unadulterated liveliness, Judge.
Oh, I would not advise the fair lady to try.
Oh, that's a good one, Hedda. Just think.
Good night. Good night, ladies.
About 10 o'clock then.
No.